like sweet, sweet honey on my lips, like the sound of a symphony to my ears, like holy water on my skin. Like holy water. spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrecting King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. The tomb where soldiers watched in vain was borrowed for 3 days. His body
sing, come. Good morning, church family, and if we have any visitors today, welcome to the Southern Cross. Just a reminder that the bi-weekly men's meeting is this Wednesday at Frank Sr.'s house, beginning at 6 p.m. This morning, Pastor Frank plans to finish chapter 3 of the book of Acts. If anyone wants to follow along in the reading, please feel free to grab one of our free Bibles at this time. Since this is Memorial Weekend, before we begin our teaching, let us take a couple minutes to remember our fallen soldiers as we watch this video.
Said at the time when he was talking to Pilate. Pilate was telling him how that, you know, he had the power to release him and these kind of things. And Jesus told him at one point, he said, "They that delivered me unto you," he said, "they have the greater sin." In other words, you're going to commit this sin by sentencing me to death. And the Roman soldiers are going to sin by crucifying me. But Jesus said, "They who delivered me to you have the greater sin." He was talking about his own Jewish brothers that conspired against him. And I'm saying all this to preface because we are going to go in a certain direction as we finish out this chapter. And so let's just follow along. After 17, let's read. I'm going to read a complimentary scripture. Levi should be able to put up on the screen that goes along with what we're saying here. Paul says over in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4. And I ask the question before I read this, how could the Jews do this in ignorance? Peter says, "You did this in ignorance." How did they do that? They are what we call the people of the book. They were the ones who wrote the Bible. They were the chosen people. Not that God is a respect of persons or likes one kind of person more than another, but they were chosen as we as individuals today are individually chosen for a specific work of God. They as a nation were chosen for a specific purpose and work for God. And so the question is, I ask us, how did they do this in ignorance? How could they crucify their Messiah, the one their prophets had been speaking about for so long, for hundreds of thousands of years? They've had prophetic writings and prophetic utterances about a coming Messiah who would take them out of bondage and renew the throne of David, you know. Back in the days of David and Solomon, those are what we call the golden era for the Jews. That's when their kingdom was at an all-time high. And they had these great majestic thrones and these kings like David and Solomon, David had been the man of war. He had brought the kingdom to peace where they could prosper. And Solomon, his son, was the great man of godly wisdom. you know, who actually ruled for quite some time in righteousness before he began to stray. And so this was known as the golden era for the Jews. And so every time the Jews, you know, when they were in bondage and they were subjugated by one of their enemy nations, they always would dream of and talk about, and you would even hear prophecies about how that one day God would send a deliverer, God would send a Messiah, and he would deliver the people from their bondage, and they would return to the glory days. He would reestablish the throne of David again, you know, and they would be independent, and they would have freedom, like we were talking about today here in America. They would have freedom to worship God according to the way he had laid it out for them. Celestria, could you give me a little more volume on the mic over there? I won't have to worry about being close to it. Turn it down for the singing, turn it up for the speaking, because it's a little different. So how could they do this in ignorance? That's the question. How could they do this in ignorance? Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4, he says, "In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God." So Paul says that they've been blinded by the God of this world. And so we read in verse 18 of the book of Acts, chapter 3, 18, picking back up. It says, "But what God foretold," this is Peter still talking, "by the mouth of all the prophets, that his Christ would suffer, he thus fulfilled." So Peter's saying, you did it in ignorance, but it's actually part of the will of God. You know, the Bible says he has his way in the good and the evil. Even if it's something evil, it's not that God condones evil, but in his great power and wisdom, he can take even an evil thing, even a bad thing, and he will actually work it into his plan to reach his goals. That's why the Bible said concerning us as individuals that all things work together for the good of them that love the Lord and for those who are called according to his purpose. So today, you know, if you're going through something, no matter what it is, if we will just place our faith in the Lord, he can redeem our pain. He can actually turn it into something good. He said, "I will cause all things to work around to your good." That is, if you love the Lord, if you're following the Lord, he'll do that. In verse 19, Peter says, "So repent, therefore, and turn again, that your sins may be blotted out, that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send the Christ appointed for you, Jesus, about which God spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets long ago." Verse 21 says, "Whom heaven must receive until the time for restoring of all things." See, all things must be restored. And that's when Jesus is coming back. What is he talking about? That's the millennium. See, in the millennial reign of Christ, for 1,000 years, he sits on the throne, and the Bible tells us that the earth is restored. It goes back to the garden state. The Bible said in that day, the desert will blossom like a rose. That is, you know, there's so many deserted, there's so many desert places, arid climates where there's nothing but sand and maybe a little cactus and tumbleweed. It says in the Bible that concerning Israel, their deserts in that day will blossom like the rose. You know, and already since the Jews have been restored to their homeland, it's phenomenal as to what they've been able to achieve, you know, in their irrigation systems and their farming and cultivating the land. They've already taken many places that were deserts. I mean, just hundreds and thousands of acres of deserts, and they've already turned it into places where they're growing crops and they've got foliage growing and all kinds of beautiful things like that. In some sense, that's a fulfillment, but it's not the full fulfillment. They're doing that by technology today. But the Bible speaks of how that God will restore everything at that time. Ever since the fall in the garden, the world has come under a great curse, and it's affected everything. But during the 1,000-year millennial reign of Christ, the Bible says he'll restore everything at that time. The curse will be lifted. The throne of David will be restored. Jesus will sit on the throne. He'll rule the nations of the world. There'll be peace, and everything will be set right. And so, when we look at this event, Peter is telling them that they had done this in ignorance, but that God had actually allowed it. He allowed it, and he's using it for his purpose. He says in verse 21, he's been received into the heavens until the time of the restoring of all things. So do you see what Peter's telling them here? He's telling them they've killed Jesus. He has since resurrected, proving he was the chosen Christ. He is the Messiah that they were supposedly waiting on, that they had made a mistake and killed the very one who had come to deliver them and raise them back up again, that they might complete their purpose in Christ and fulfill their destiny. But he's telling them, since you've done this, God's going to work it into his plan. But in the meantime, he says, Christ has gone back to heaven, whom the heavens have received until the time of the restoring of all things. That is, he'll remain in heaven until it's time for the millennium to set in, where all things will be restored. And so we have to ask ourselves now, when will this happen? What will change that will cause the Jews to receive their Messiah? What's going to happen? I mean, for 2,000 years they haven't received it. Now, there have been lots of Jews saved, you know, just like any other nation of people. But I'm speaking majorly. You know, the Bible is speaking on average. It's speaking how that as a whole, the nation is still in rebellion against their Messiah. They're still in denial, I should say. Maybe that's a better way to term it. They're still in denial concerning Jesus. And so he's gone to the Gentile nations in the meantime. We don't have time to get into it this morning. I'd love to, but it'd take way too long. Paul goes on and on explaining this mystery, how that God, you know, he used this, because you may have wondered earlier when I said, how does he use the crucifixion, you know, work that out for good? How does he work it into his plan? First of all, Christ died for the sins of the world. Plus, it gives the Gentiles a chance, Paul said, an opportunity to hear the gospel. For if the Jews had received their Messiah, that they would have reestablished the throne. They would have fulfilled their purpose. You know, when Jesus came to the cross, there was only 7 years left in the prophecy of Daniel concerning the 70 weeks determined upon the Jews. At that point in time, there was only 7 years left. If they had received him in 7 years, that would have wrapped up God's plan. And the Gentiles would have never had a chance, an opportunity for all these hundreds of years to come to the Lord. God could have never filled the kingdom of God with all these Gentile believers. They wouldn't have had the opportunities that we've had today. The plan of God would have been wrapped up while the nations of the world would have still been pagans and unbelievers. But Paul said, oh, how great, how deep, how wise God is, you know, in that he has worked these things out this way. For he said, blindness has come in part to the Jews. They've been blinded in part until the days of the Gentiles be fulfilled. Or he said it like this, until the fullness of the Gentiles come in. And that's what I'm getting around to. I said all of that to work my way around to this. They will believe on their Messiah when the days of the Gentiles have come to an end, when the fullness, as Paul called it, the fullness of the Gentiles come in. See, that's a very mysterious thing, but let's take just a few minutes before we close this morning and look at that. Now, I'm sure, you know, some may be thinking, well, you know, what's he talking about here? Well, let's go to Romans. Levi can put this on the screen. Romans chapter 11, starting with verse 25. Paul says this over in Romans. He's talking about this very subject I'm talking about. And he says it like this. Lest you be wise in your own sight, I want you to understand this mystery. See, it's a mystery. Brothers, a partial hardening has come upon Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. Now, he calls it hardening there. In the King James Version, if you're reading from that Bible, it's called blindness. Blindness in part has come to the Jews till the number of the Gentiles be fulfilled. In almost all other translations, it's a hardening. That is, their hearts have been hardened. And God has allowed it. He's actually used it to fulfill his purpose. The fact they hardened their hearts caused them not to see the Messiah when he came. You remember Jesus stood over Jerusalem right before he was crucified, saying, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, O you who kill the prophets and stone every wise man sent to you, how often I would have gathered you together as a mother hen gathers her brood, but you were not willing. He said, therefore your houses are now left unto you desolate, until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. That's what Jesus said over them before he went to the cross. It was a great curse he was leveling against Jerusalem. Because he said, your houses are now left unto you desolate, Desolate means without the Spirit. They're empty. There's no spiritual, you know, moving of God there anymore. And sure enough, what happened? God went to the Gentiles to get Himself a bride. He went to the Gentiles to collect a people for His name's sake. He brought the gospel to the nations of the world. See, you see what he said right there in Romans. This, he called it the fullness of the Gentiles, until the fullness of the Gentiles come in. Now, real quick, there is another phrase in the Bible we call the time of the Gentiles. It's actually different. The fullness of the Gentiles, the time of the Gentiles. I'm not splitting hairs or, you know, trying to create a sermon that's based on semantics. It's really not. It's not important that we remember these two phrases, but it's more important to remember the definition of them. There's two aspects to the Gentile time. There is the fullness of the Gentiles, what Paul spoke of. What he's basically saying is, until the last person destined to be saved among the Gentile nations comes in, Israel will not receive their Messiah. You know, all these millions of Gentiles coming to the faith, hearing the gospel, Paul says, until their full number comes in, until the fullness of them comes in, Israel will remain blind. They'll remain hardened against their Messiah. They won't be able to see it. But then we have what is referred to by Jesus in the book of Luke as the time of the Gentiles. Let's read that. If Levi can put that on the screen, it's Luke chapter 21, starting with verse 24. Jesus says, "They will fall by the edge of the sword," talking about Israel, "and be led captive among all nations," which they did after 70 AD. They were destroyed and dispersed. And he said, "And Jerusalem will be trampled underfoot by the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled." Now notice, Paul said that the Jews will remain hardened against the Messiah until the full number of the Gentiles come in. Jesus says, Jerusalem will be trampled underfoot by the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled. So what we have here is a spiritual application and a natural application. See, the number of the Gentiles has to do with us as individuals getting saved. Some have made this statement, you know, and I'm sure it's true to some extent, that there's somebody is the last Gentile meant to be saved. There will be some last soul eventually come in. And when their heart yields to the Lord, that'll be the final one. And immediately the eyes of the Jews will begin to come open. They'll begin to understand what they did. There'll be a great shift that will take place. But here Jesus was talking about the nations of the Gentiles, not the Gentile believers. See, the fullness of the Gentiles coming in so that the Jews can then come back in is salvation to the Gentile nations. You see what I'm saying? The times of the Gentiles that Jesus spoke of is the times that the Gentile nations of the world will be in power and be ruling over the Jews, be trampling their city down, making the rules, you know, these kind of things. The times of the Gentiles. There's some debate over when the time of the Gentiles ended, but there's not really any over when it started. The times of the Gentile nations coming into power, when the Jewish nation went out of power, was in Babylon. It was around 600 BC or so. When Judah was taken down into Babylon captive, we talked about some of that in the Apocalypse series. When they were taken down into Babylon, that was the beginning of the times of the Gentiles. Because if you look at it biblically and historically, from the time that Babylon took the Jews down into Babylon, took them captive, from that point up until today, the Jews have never been, they've never been in power again. Since 1948, that's the closest they've come to it. It was 1948 that they were recognized as a nation again, that the United Nations got together, drew up a resolution, recognized them as a nation, gave them a part of the land over there in what they call Palestine. Today we know it as Israel. It's biblically known as Israel. That was the first time they had been in charge of their own land, the Promised Land, since they went down into Babylon. Now somebody might say, well, Frank, the Bible, according to Bible and history, you know, 70 years later after going down into Babylon, they returned. You remember Cyrus issued a decree and let a large remnant go back and rebuild the temple, rebuild the walls. But the thing was, they never were fully in charge of their land then. They were still under the powers of Babylon. The Babylon had control. They had to give them permission to go back. They could control who was their king. You know, and it went from Babylon to the Medes and the Persians, and it went from the Medes and the Persians to the Greeks, and it went from the Greeks to the Romans. See, since then, they've never been in charge of their promised land, even when they were allowed to be there. They had puppet kings, even during the days of Jesus. Look, Herod was the king, and he was, you remember, he killed all the children when he heard a Messiah was being born. He was a wicked king, but he was there by permission of the Romans. They installed him. You know, they had people like that. So it wasn't until 1948, the greatest sign of the return of Jesus we've ever seen and will ever see in our lifetime took place then, when Israel became a nation again. They haven't yet received their Messiah, but they're well on their way. So I just wanted to say that there's so much that could be said, but I wanted to say a little bit right quick to bring about a distinguishment between the time of the Gentiles and the fullness of the Gentiles. One has to do with the Gentile nations being in power in the earth and the Jews being out of power. The other has to do with the Gentiles coming to Christ, being saved, the fullness of the Gentiles coming in so that the Jews might come in. They're connected to each other, you know, they run concurrent in many ways, but there are differences between them. So where we are today is we are right on the verge of Israel coming back in and God turning back. Because see, here's what happens. When Israel comes back in, when the fullness of the Gentiles comes and God turns his attention back toward the nation of Israel that he might complete his purpose for them, there will be only 7 years. There's 7 years left on the clock. That's why the Bible calls it the last week of Daniel. The tribulation is the last week of Daniel. It's 7 years. And once the clock starts ticking, and it's marked by an agreement we hear about in the Old Testament. You know, you go back and read the book of Daniel, there's some chapters in there that correspond perfectly with the book of Revelation, even giving us more detail about some things than the book of Revelation. One of those things is about Antichrist making a deal with Israel, the man of sin, the lawless one. He makes a covenant with Israel that he has no intentions of keeping. He makes a 7-year covenant. Now, once he makes this 7-year covenant, the clock starts ticking. Because it tells us in the book of Daniel that after 3.5 years into this 7-year covenant, that he'll break the covenant. He'll renege on the Jews. He'll go back on his covenant, his agreement, his contract, his word. He'll go back on it, and all hell will break loose. And the Jews will realize they've been had. See, the thing is, if you look at it spiritually, it's so phenomenal what happened. When they rejected Jesus, they received the Antichrist. When they rejected their Christ, they received the Antichrist. See, and it happened in the mind of God, in a spiritual sense, it happened immediately. We see it 2,000 years later, but you got to understand God resides outside the time domain. And if you look at this through the eyes of Revelation and through the eyes of a spiritual perspective, you'll see what I'm talking about. When they rejected Jesus, see, it come up to, there were 490 years prophesied on the Jews. The prophet said 490 years. And everything will be complete. God's plan for the Jews will be complete. He says it'll usher in everlasting righteousness. He said it'll seal up the vision. He said it'll be the time when they anoint the most holy, that is, anoint the temple and anoint the king that sits on the throne. And he went down this list of things that would happen after 490 years, 70 weeks, it was called, a year for a day. 7 days for 7 years, 70 weeks ends up being 490 years. And he said this will begin, the clock will start ticking when you hear the command go forth to rebuild Jerusalem. And so when that command went forth from Babylon to rebuild Jerusalem, it started, the prophecy clock started. And it ran all the way up to Calvary. And all the way up to Calvary you had 483 years had passed, leaving 7 years to finish that 490 year prophecy. Because remember, after 490 years, that's the end. That's the end of the world. The Jews come into power. It wraps everything up. God's plan is complete. There was 7 years left. And they killed Jesus. But the prophecy said they would. It said after that many years, it said Messiah will be cut off. It said, but not for himself, it'll be for the people. And that's what happened. He was killed, not for his own crimes, but for the sin of humanity. And he was cut off. And what happened? The clock stopped. Because see, God wasn't dealing with the Jews anymore. They killed the Messiah, and it brought their prophetic timeline to a stop, a standstill. This is why you hear religious people say sometimes that Israel is God's timepiece. You want to know where God is in his plan? You look at the nation of Israel. They give you a keen look into what the Lord is doing and where we are in time. Because it's the only nation on the earth God ever gave a timeline to concerning the end of the world. And so here they are. Jesus is crucified. Time stops. There's 7 years left. But time stopped. Nobody knew how long it was going to stay stopped. The Jews fell into confusion. They didn't understand why things didn't continue to unfold. Less than 40 years after they crucified Jesus, the great curse came on Israel that Jesus had pronounced when he stood and said their houses would be desolate. Remember? They crucified him. Less than 40 years later, a Roman general named Titus rode in there with an army and leveled Jerusalem. Destroyed the temple. You remember Jesus had prophesied to them when they told Jesus, look at this great temple you know we have now. They were proud of the fact that the Romans let them have this beautiful temple and they had even embellished on it. They had added to it, remodeled it, and it was wonderful. But Jesus said, I tell you, not one stone of this temple will be left upon another. They'll all be thrown down. It sounded absurd. You know, usually you destroy a place, there's always a few stones left connected. But Jesus said, not one will be left. And sure enough, 70 AD, they rode in, burnt the temple to the ground, destroyed it, killed the Jews. Some were scattered throughout Europe. It was a terrible thing. And they ended up, some history tells us, that they went in there and they broke every stone apart. Because when the temple burnt, precious metals ran down and got between the stones in the mortar. So they had to break each one apart to get the gold and stuff out. So that would explain why not one stone was left on another. And of course, you can go over there today. Whatever the case is, you can't find a single stone of that temple left on another. They all go to what they call the Wailing Wall, which is not the temple, but that's where they go to. That's all that's left as to some kind of memorabilia, you know, to where they can get back to something that's connected to something sacred to them. And they go there, you know, to put prayers in the wall on paper, and they pray and do different rituals. But anyway, 7 years left, but time stopped, and 2,000 years has passed. But God has been dealing with the Gentiles. See, he didn't give the Gentiles them prophecies. He didn't give them a timeline, so nobody knows. Nobody knows how long it'll be, but Jesus did give us signs. He gave us signs of the time we can watch for that we will know when it's close, even at the door. And we've gone over a lot of those in the Revelation series. We see signs today that let us know we're right there at the threshold. But anyway, I said all that to say this, that when Antichrist, according to the Bible, when Antichrist signs this contract with Israel, it's a 7-year contract. So it's that last 7 years, the last 7 years of Daniel, the last week of Daniel. It's the tribulation period. That's when the tribulation begins. And of course, we also attach the rapture of the church to that. About the time of the signing, somewhere around there will be a catching away, according to Paul. And the church will be called up. Those who have surrendered their heart to Christ, not every believer, not every religious person, but Jesus said, you won't see the kingdom of God unless you've been born again. There must be a new birth, a regeneration. There must be true repentance. When this happens, then we're sealed into that number. When this time comes, we will be caught up in a moment in the twinkling of an eye, the Bible says, at the sounding of the last trump. We'll be caught up into the air to meet the Lord in the sky, and we'll forever be with the Lord. It'll be the great catching away, the great rapture, and the 7 years will set in. So we have what we are right now. We're in the days of the Gentiles. We're in that time where God is fulfilling the number of the Gentiles, and it's almost over. Jesus said, when this gospel goes throughout the world for a witness, then will the end come. And that's what we're looking for today. I'm going to read a couple more scriptures right quick before we close out that parallels our theme here. In Romans chapter 11, verse 1, Levi, he doesn't have these two scriptures I'm fixing to read. These came in after he had finished his work on the computer. Romans chapter 11 says, God, has God rejected his people? This is Paul. You remember Paul was the one who spoke in chapter 11 earlier I read to you where he spoke of the fullness of the Gentiles coming in. He says, has God rejected his people? By no means, Paul says, for I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham. So Paul is making sure we understand that it's a temporary thing, that they're not fully and forever cut off from God as a nation. Now remember, as individuals, we all have the same opportunity. It doesn't matter the race, the creed, the nationality, Jew, Gentile, whatever. Bond free, rich or poor, male, female, doesn't matter, adult, child. If we can surrender our heart to Christ, anybody can be saved. But we're talking about how God deals with nations and his purpose for them. In Acts 15, if we go there, it gives us a little more insight too. It says, God visited the Gentiles to take from them a people for his name. And with this, the words of the prophets agree, just as it is written. After this, I will return and I will rebuild the tabernacle of David that has fallen. I will rebuild its ruins and I will restore it, that the remnant of mankind may seek the Lord and all Gentile nations who are called by my name. See, right there he's telling us over in Acts 15 that there's a time coming when he will again rebuild the tabernacle of David. That's an old word for a tent. Some translate it as a booth. It's basically the house of David. It has been translated as the fallen down house of David. He's going to rebuild the house, the throne. In other words, in the Old Testament, when it spoke of a man's house, a patriarch's house, his tabernacle, it was speaking of his domain, his extended family, his estate, his power, his authority. He's going to come back and restore that for the millennium. And anyway, I think I'll go ahead and stop there. I don't want to go too far. And we'll end up losing what we have, you know, because we get too much information. But I hope that I've said something this morning that resonates with you and makes sense and gives you a foundation for learning. These are things that if we can understand them, they give us a kind of a platform, you know, something to build on. We can go into the scriptures and we can better understand some of the deeper things, some of the more mysterious things, you know, in God's plan and what he's laid out for us in scripture. Today we are the church. God has called us out of the world. The Bible said, come out of the world and be a separate people, and I'll receive you, says the Lord. And he's called us out today as his church. I remind you the word church, it comes from the Greek word ekklesia, which means the called out and assembled. He's called us out. Just like Moses called the children of Israel out of Egypt with plagues. I'll say this real quick. He dropped the 10 plagues on Egypt right there at the end. To break Egypt, to break the back of Egypt, to break the power of Egypt, to break the pride of Egypt, to break their stronghold over the children of Israel, right down to the last plague before they relinquished and they let go of the children of Israel and they were able to leave. See, in the same way, it was a type. Jesus, the man likened to Moses, the Bible calls him the prophet likened to Moses. Jesus came for the church. Moses is to the Jews of the Old Testament what Christ is to the church in the New Testament. Christ has come and delivered his people from spiritual Egypt. And it will culminate in the tribulation with the plagues once again. If you remember the pouring out of the bowls, you end up seeing most of those plagues over in the tribulation. Once again, except this time not one nation, but poured out on the world to relinquish Satan's hold over God's people. And that is, people are interwoven with spirits. We're caught up in the world, addictions, all kinds of bad habits and lifestyles. But God will, in the tribulation period, he will send those plagues once again. And eventually, after 7 years of that, Satan will relinquish his hold because God will devastate this earth just like he did Egypt. The Bible said Egypt lied in ruins when God was through. He was devastated. And the world will be the same way. He's coming down on this earth with plagues, and he'll have no choice but to bow, the Bible said. And that day, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess. He is Lord to the glory of God. And Jesus will then be able to set up his throne with no resistance from this world. There won't be in any shape to fight back. So, just a perfect type of what took place in Egypt, but it's the church this time. So anyway, appreciate everybody coming out who did and were able to come out today. Really means a lot to me. I hope you'll invite somebody. Next week is Communion Sunday. So if there's anybody who has a testimony this week, who has had an experience with the Lord, I hope that you'll prepare your heart to come up and share it with us next Sunday.